It is, then, equally a deception of oneself and of others if it is pretended that what one is concerned with is the matter in hand alone. A consciousness that opens up a subject matter soon learns that others hurry along like flies to freshly poured out milk and want to busy themselves with it. And they learn about that individual that he, too, is concerned with the subject matter, not as an object, but as his own affair. On the other hand, if what is supposed to be essential is merely the doing of it, the employment of powers and capacities, or the expression of this particular individuality, then equally it is learned by all parties that they all regard themselves as affected and invited to participate. And instead of a mere doing or a separate action peculiar to the individual who opened up the subject matter, something has been opened up that is for others as well, or is a subject matter on its own account. In both cases, the same thing happens and only has a different significance by contrast with what was assumed and was supposed to be accepted. Consciousness experiences both sides as equally essential moments, and in doing so learns what the nature of the matter in hand really is. That is, that it is neither merely something which stands opposed to action in general and to individual action, nor action which stands opposed to a continuing being, and which would be the free genus of these moments as its species. Rather is its nature such that its being is the action of the single individual and of all individuals, and whose action is immediately for others, or is a matter in hand, and is such only as the action of each and everyone, the essence which is the essence of all beings, that is, spiritual essence. Consciousness learns that no one of these moments is subject, but rather gets dissolved in the universal matter in hand. The moments of the individuality which this unthinking consciousness regarded as subject, one after the other, coalesce into simple individuality, which, as this particular individuality, is no less immediately universal. Thus, the matter in hand no longer has the character of a predicate and loses the characteristic of lifeless abstract universality. It is, rather, substance permeated by individuality, subject in which there is individuality just as much qua individual or qua this particular individual as qua all individuals. And it is the universal which has being only as this action of all and each, and a reality in the fact that this particular consciousness knows it to be its own individual reality and the reality of all. The pure matter in hand itself is what was defined above as the category, being that is the I, or the I that is being, but in the form of thought which is still distinguished from actual self-consciousness. Here, however, the moments of actual self-consciousness, insofar as we call them its content, purpose, action, and reality, and also insofar as we call them its form, being for self and being for another, are posited as one with the simple category itself, and the category is thereby at the same time the entire content. We finish up this section, The Spiritual Animal Kingdom and Deceit, with paragraph 418, another very long paragraph in which some very important resolutions are taking place and the transition to the next sections, the remaining subsections, that is, of this massive reason section. We're now almost at the edge where we can glimpse what's going to be happening in spirit, not least since Hegel here is going to talk about a spiritual essence being involved in the matter in hand, or the heart of the matter, the Zaka Zelps, and he's also going to talk in terms of categories. So there's a lot going on in this section. And there's really an important transition from the initial way of looking at things, which was how paragraph 417 just before it, and the other remaining paragraphs before that were leading up to, and this important resolution that takes place. So let's start with what's here on the bottom. Hegel begins by saying, it's equally a deception of oneself and others if it's pretended that what one is concerned with is the matter in hand alone. This is, sort of a pretense of objectivity or of disinterestedness, when really the whole reason
why the individuality is concerned with the matter in hand, or the affair of the Zaka, is that it does have some meaning for it. It has some purpose. There's a desire to achieve some sort of satisfaction going on here. And insofar as that's the case, others are necessarily drawn in and present there as well. So Hegel has this very interesting metaphor that you should try sometime. A consciousness that opens up a subject matter soon learns that others hurry along like flies to freshly poured out milk and want to busy themselves with it. And they learn about that individual that he too is concerned with the subject matter, not as an object, but as his own affair. So the others, as soon as you become interested in something enough that you're making a little bit of progress with it, they also see that it's interesting. They would like to make it their own. So, you know, you pour out milk on the ground, fresh milk, not just, you know, the pasteurized stuff that most of us drink. Although I think flies would probably eat that as well, right? And flies start settling on it. You could do this with other things as well. Think about when you're at, if you're in, you know, the kind of context here in America that we have, when, you know, it's the middle of summer, and you go out and have a picnic and open up some, you know, cans of soda, and you've got some sandwiches with meat, and suddenly the yellow jackets, these wasps that live in the ground, start coming out. They're actually carnivorous, by the way, and they start, you know, getting onto your stuff, and you brush them away, but you're a little bit worried because they might sting you. By the way, if they do sting you, they introduce a pheromone that tells other yellow jackets to come and sting you as well, so you don't want to sting them or even crush them. But what's going on there? There's this sort of image like, hey, I was here first, and I started out with this, and then all the rest of you came along, and you're glomming on to what I'm doing. But there's self-deception involved there. How did you get involved in what you're doing in the first place, right? Probably you saw somebody else doing something similar. And this holds for so many things. It holds for activities. It holds for whether you pursue a relationship with another person. There's, this component of what other authors have called mimetic desire. We know that something is worth desiring because we see other people desiring it and working on it. Only this goes beyond mere desiring and has to do with interest and work and action. So the consciousness is involved with the matter at hand as its own thing. All these other consciousnesses do the same thing. Looks like the dynamic that we just explored in the last paragraph, doesn't it? So he says, on the other hand, if what is supposed to be essential is merely the doing of it, the employment of powers and capacities, or the expression of this particular individuality, we have to remember back a number of paragraphs in order to bring this back into our purview here. There was what we call the original nature, or the capacities, or gifts, or talents of the person. And Hegel has been gradually working with this. The matter in hand allows us, you might say, a material or a forum in which we can bring those things out. And that's part of what a person is trying to express. The woodworker who has talent for that wants to work wood. So they seek out the wood that they can carve and occasions for producing the, you know, whatever it is that they're doing. The person who really enjoys digging holes, and I'll you know, the reason I bring that up is I was, in fact, a kid who was like that. I enjoyed taking a shovel and digging in the dirt and seeing how far down we could go and shoring up the sides. And, you know, you end up building forts and other cool stuff. At one time, you know, not fully understanding what I was doing when I was, you know, very young, I thought I could dig to the other side of the world. Then learned a little bit about, you know, the nature of earth science and was dissuaded from that project, but not before I'd gotten, you know, a number of feet down when I look back at it. Anyway, you know, the matter in hand allows a medium in which the original nature of the person can be expressed in ways that are meaningful, that produce something. So he says, then it's learned by all parties that they all regard themselves as affected and invited to participate. And instead of a mere doing or separate action peculiar to the individual who opened up the subject matter, something has been opened up that is for others as well, or is a subject matter on its own account. So, you know, if we want to use the hole digging thing, the other kids on the block see me digging holes and they're like, I want to get in on that action. That looks like a lot of fun. And some of them will dig their own holes, right? If we take something a little less juvenile, think about how it works with important topics. Somebody writes an essay saying that we should pay attention to this phenomenon over here, and for a while they're the person who goes on the lecture circuit and talks about it and gets on TV and, you know, writes the books. And then other people come along fairly quickly and say, well, that person, it's great that they opened up this subject matter. Now let's do it better. I'm going to write another book, and this one will be, you know, going beyond what this author did. And quite often it does, because, I mean, that's the way human knowledge builds. Artwork works like that as well. Music works like that. If you think about the, you know, just dramatic and so rapid development in rock and roll music since, you know, let's just sort of arbitrarily say beginnings in the 50s and 60s, and all the massive transformations that took place in the 60s, 70s, 80s, producing new genres, introducing all sorts of new techniques. You know, we start zeroing in on subgenres and subgenres. It's you know, startling. I use a lot of examples from heavy metal because that's what I know the best. So think about, for example, you know, some of the originators, right? Not just Black Sabbath, but also Deep Purple, you know, Led Zeppelin, arguably, Uriah Heep, some other bands as well that are doing this stuff that it's kind of, you know, at least Black Sabbath, it's definitely heavy metal. These other bands, well, it's kind of bluesy. It's kind of something else. You know, it's a little bit UFO, a little bit hard to pin down. And then, you know, the bands that come after them are taking elements and discarding elements. They're all still working with the same matter in hand, making music, rock and roll, right? So that by the time that you get to a band like Motorhead in the, you know, mid-70s, late-70s, they're not calling what they do heavy metal, by the way. We just play rock and roll. But their rock and roll is light years beyond what Deep Purple and even Black Sabbath were doing at their time. I'm not saying they're necessarily greater or better, but they're certainly doing something quite different. And then they inspire other bands in turn, right? And other bands and other bands. And everybody can take, you know, these things and make something of it. And they can even use the same old standards. So, you know, Motorhead can do Train Kept a Rollin' All Night Long, even though Aerosmith did it. And when Aerosmith did it, it was also a cover of somebody else, right? And you know, people do covers of Motorhead songs later on. And then, you know, those bands produce their own things. Everybody is getting into the matter at hand in their own way. So whether it's music, whether it's scholarship, whether it's fashion, whether it is design, people are constantly doing this sort of thing. All right, that's a long set of examples. Let's go back to the text, right? So he says, in both cases, the same thing happens and only has a different significance by contrast with what was assumed and was supposed to be accepted. Now here's where we have the transition. Consciousness experiences both sides as equally essential moments, and in doing so, learns what the nature of the matter in hand really is. What is the matter in hand? It's been misunderstanding it this entire time. It's neither merely something which stands opposed to action in general and to individual action, nor action which stands opposed to a continuing being and which would be the free genus of these moments as its species. This is going back to previous paragraphs. These are ways in which the matter in hand was conceived, right? Rather, it is its nature such that its being is the action of the single individual. Okay, we have that, right? It's the action of the single individual, but also the action of all individuals. It's both. And whose action is immediately for others? I don't have this on the board, but that's important as well. To be the action of the single individual and the action of all individuals means being action for others. You don't get to keep your own action entirely to yourself as the single individual. There is this necessarily universalizing aspect or dynamic to the matter in hand. Then, Hegel says, or is a matter in hand and is such only as the action of each and everyone. Each and everyone. That's a little bit different than just saying all individuals. Jedes, alles. Alles Einzelheit for all individuals, right? Here we're getting to something that goes beyond merely an aggregate to something that Hegel is going to say is a spiritual essence. He says, the essence which is the essence of all beings, that is, spiritual essence, geistige. We shouldn't see this as, you know, sort of ghostly spiritual. We should see this understood the way that Hegel understands spirit, where there's this constant movement towards a complex matrix in which we recognize each other and we all sort of fit in. And there is some room for dynamism, for movement, but without destroying the entire structure in the process, and where each has its fullest meaning within the matrix, not just all by itself, not just as an aggregate of a bunch of particular individuals, the action of each and everyone. This is an ideal, of course. It's not fully realized. But he goes on and he says, consciousness learns no one of these moments is subject, but rather gets dissolved in the universal matter in hand. The moments of the individuality which this unthinking consciousness regarded as subject, think back to when we talked about the matter in hand and the elements or dimensions of action. Aim or end, purpose, also Zweck, means, Mittel, action itself, circumstances or reality, and original capacities or talents or nature, effects. All these things were treated as being subjects that the matter in hand was merely a predicate of. Now we get rid of that. These coalesce into a simple individuality, which as this particular individuality is no less immediately universal. So he says, thus the matter in hand no longer has the character of a predicate. What does it mean to have the character of a predicate here? The predicate is something added on to the subject. The predicate is something in many ways less essential, less at the core of things than the subject is. The subject in ancient Greek, the hupokeimenon, is that in which predicates, that's what predicates can be applied to, because the predicates describe qualities or other things that we can categorize about them, that we can predicate of them, right? The predicate is in some ways less essential. So Hegel is saying, look, the matter in hand, it's been treated as if it's a predicate, but it's not a predicate. It's not less essential. It is what is essential. Why? It loses the character of lifeless, abstract universality. It's rather, notice what he says here, substance permeated by individuality. Subject in which there is individuality, just as much qua individual or qua this particular individual as qua all individuals. So you get to have your own individuality and the matter in hand being something that matters for you, but not by excluding everybody else. You can have it, but you have to recognize that other people also have their sharing in it and their perspectives upon it. Because what matters more is the matter in hand. So he goes on and he says, it is the universal which has being only as this action of all and each, and a reality in the fact that this particular consciousness knows it to be its own individual reality and the reality of all. This is a very important insight that it's not, you know, not necessary that everybody makes it to. In fact, a lot of people never do realize this. Or if they do realize it, they realize it only in a way that reflects the previous dialectical developments in this section, where they're still sort of projecting onto everybody else that everybody else needs to either get with their program or be like them, see things the same way as them. This may even be unconscious on the part of many people, but you know, you can observe it in them and, of course, in ourselves. Here, to recognize one's own involvement is to recognize that other people can be similarly involved, and that doesn't necessarily have to stand in the way of or contradict or lessen your own involvement. As a matter of fact, it may enhance it. In genuinely spiritual activities, the way that Hegel understands them, there is this greater whole generated from the interaction of the parts. Really, they're only parts insofar as they're part of a whole, is another way of saying it. So he goes on and he says, the pure matter in hand itself is what was defined above as the category. This is a term Hegel likes, right? Being that is the I, or the I that is being, but in the form of thought, which is still distinguished from actual self-consciousness. There's still a disjunction here. But he says, here, however, the moments of actual self-consciousness, insofar as we call them its content, so purpose, action, and reality, and also insofar as we call them its form, think back again to previous paragraphs, two paragraphs before, being for self and being for other, are posited as one within the simple category itself, and the category is thereby at the same time the entire content. So in this case, as opposed to some other transitions to other sections, we really do have an important resolution here. Of course, this is just the very beginning of that, and what it means for these things to be united into this category, that's not clear. But the fact that they have been brought into this single category, which is not just a category apart from individuality or apart from consciousness, it is a category of individual self-consciousness, which at the same time involves the action or the consciousness of all and each. This now needs to be worked out. That is what is going to happen in the following two sections, and then we will make the big transition to the whole spirit section.